Yes, we're good to go.
Okay, if you spotlight, so salam, peace and shalom. Welcome back everyone to our Film and Faith series, which I am absolutely loving. We all know that religion and film is an important part of our culture because they reflect values, dreams, and even hopes of our society. And film specifically has become a very powerful medium because more people in our culture on any given weekend attend or go to theater than attend a worship service. So this has become a very common, a very popular and very powerful practice of our community. So in this class, Louis, can you hear the disturbance?
Please, if you're not speaking, can you make sure to mute your microphone for me? Thank you so much.
Thank you. I really appreciate it because I was hearing back my echo a lot. So again, welcome back to our class sponsored by the Interfaith Center, co-sponsored by Spirituality and Practice and Process and Faith. Along with me is Dr. J. McDaniel, our facilitator, our teacher. And without much ado, I want to go to our two movies of the day, which I absolutely love, both of them. So we have The Band's Visit that Ellen Polsky is facilitating today, and My Octopus Teacher, which I am facilitating. And as always, I'll remind you that it's not the content of the movie which is really important in this specific class. It's more of the experience, the spiritual and the religious experience it generates within us, and then we bring it to this space to share with everybody. So having said that, Ellen Polsky, you are on with The Band's Visit, and I can't wait to see the trailer.
So The Band's Visit is a story about Israelis and Egyptians, but not really. And I think that if you have watched the trailer, you'll realize that it goes way, way, way beyond that, although that is sort of in the background, but that it's a story about humanity, about loneliness, perhaps, about trying to have or do more than perhaps you are doing. It's about, I think, individuals. And the fact that, I'll just say that the very beginning where the band is, the Egyptian band, the ceremonial band, is dropped off at the airport in Israel and is not met by the people that they expected to be met for, with, and then had to negotiate on their own to get to a place called Petach Tikva. But because of the way the language is pronounced, they ended up in a place called Beit HaTikva, which is actually a fictional place. But the Hebrew words Beit HaTikva is a house of hope. And so this fictional place that they're going to actually speaks to us about hope, which I think is also a theme of this film. So I think with that, it would be time to watch the trailer. And then, Sophia, tell me if I'm staying on track.
You are right on track. Okay.
We would watch the trailer. And then there are two questions that I thought about, but certainly people could, you know, will have other questions. So.
خلينا اي اتوبيس بيوصل لبيت بيت هاتكبا
بيت
more of cultures and
culture. Not culture, not Israeli culture, not Arab, not culture at all.
Jahannam.
Would you coffee?
Yes.
No, please, we're fine.
Going out? Good time.
How I look?
Very fine indeed.
Clothes nice.
Yes. Like Michael Jackson.
So what do you do in the orchestra? What do you play?
I play the clarinet.
Do you like Chet Baker?
Who?
You don't go with girls a lot, huh?
No. What's it like? أرجوكم ما تنسوش إن إحنا هنا بنمس مصر وأنا بطلب منكم التصرف السليم وإنكم تكونوا مع الدليل
لمت أيامنا المنسية
There's just so much symbolism in this movie, so much in terms of the beautiful photography, the music, the choices that they make with regard to what they share with one another, but also I think the background music and certainly the language, the way they use language and have to resort basically to English, a language that is not common to either the Egyptian orchestra or the Israelis, and how they speak about language in terms of that it's music to them. And so music sort of permeates this entire movie, I feel. The questions that I thought about are that it's a story about the human experience, and that there are longings of these people who are the characters in the film about their destinies that have not been fulfilled, or about their wishes for maybe a different life than what they have, but they seem to be sort of stuck. And so I wonder why we are so willing to accept substitutes for love or art or the things that nourish us, would be my first question. The second question is, how do we unlock the prisons that we might find ourselves in? How do we move forward from a place where we feel like we might be stuck? So we see how the characters, or we hope what the characters, how they might continue, but they might not. And, you know, how does that affect us in terms of our own souls and spirituality?
Ellen, can you respond briefly on how you would answer those questions?
I for my own personal experience, for my own personal life, you mean?
Yes.
I think that for me, I never saw myself as a particularly spiritual person. And so I'm really seeking that out to try. Sophia has spoken with me. I've asked her questions. I've interviewed her, in fact, about how does she do that? And how could I get some of that? And how do I discipline myself to be part of that? And taking classes like this and really trying to uncover some parts of me that I just haven't been able to access before. I think that's why I look at this film as saying, you can do this, guys, because I'm making an attempt. So I know that you can do this too. And sometimes, even though I don't live in a Negev desert and it's not so stark around me, sometimes I feel like it really is stark and lonely. And how do I move on, because only faith in I guess, God's protection, but that God has given me the ability to do this. I just have to access that. It's kind of what moves me very slowly, very slowly. I'm running out of time. I'm 73. So who knows how long it's going to take, but you know, I feel like I'm on a path in that way. And I have accepted love and other things when I probably should have looked beyond that. You know, I sort of got in a place, well, if this is what God has sent in my direction, this must be what I'm supposed to do. And I've actually learned that my tuition might be better than that. And that it's one thing to trust in God, but it's another thing to trust in your own intuition as well. And I think the unfinished clarinet concerto says to me that, you know what, if you spent a little bit more time, you've got this music in you. You just have to put it down on paper. Mm-hmm. And that really spoke to me a lot in this movie.
Good. Thanks, Ellen. And so let's have some others respond either to Ellen's questions or to what she just said, which I think probably speaks to a lot of us.
Anybody? I felt the strongest theme of the movie that I felt was that sense of being stuck. Every character in that movie was stuck somewhere in their life that they did not want to be. Mm-hmm. The other themes of loneliness and connection, they were there, but to me, not as strongly as that sense of being stuck. Both like emotionally, physically, they were stuck in this town. Emotionally, they were stuck. The people who lived in the town were stuck emotionally. So that was very strong for me. How do we get unstuck? I know the times when I have been stuck in my life, when I finally had enough, I gritted my teeth and got out. But I've also always had a very strong defense against getting stuck in all different ways. I mean, I have seen people who were really paralyzed by all different ways that they were stuck in their lives and would do things purposely to not become like that, to be able to get out of it. So I think there are things we can do. And I just wanted to say, Ellen, that this is another thing that I have often like thought to myself about, of the place of art, music, creativity. What is creativity in my life? And the reason that schools and other, you know, places that it's given up so easily is because it costs money to live in what we consider an art world costs money, either for your materials, for classes, to buy what it is that you like, to teach it in the schools. It's expensive. And that is always the first to go, either personally or politically or, you know, in a school setting. It's not given the same importance as individuals might see. And I've reframed what is creative for myself, that everything that I do expresses my sense of creativity. The one that comes to mind the most is cooking, because as you know, I cook by color. I don't cook by flavor or taste. I cook by color and texture. And I don't taste it as I go along. It's always a surprise. I don't follow recipes. It's, to me, it's always been an extremely creative activity, personally. So when I was a mother with three young babies and I had no time to draw or paint or do anything like that, I felt that it expressed myself with food. I never let the kids in the kitchen when I was cooking. I just could, that was my time for me. And you, Ellen, are one of the most creative people I know. You're like Becky, but I'm not talented. I don't have this. I can't do that. Your talent is people. Your talent is your imagination, what you think of to get your ideas across. You are one of the most creative people I know. And we limit ourselves by saying, no, only this is creative. This is not creative. Only this is artistic. This is not artistic. So.
All right, Deb, thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Anybody else want to respond? Carol, go ahead.
Oh yeah, I just went off on a different track all of a sudden. I don't know why, but insertion of the divine in our life is what is a surprise in the movie. Like they get taken to a new place. It's not like they decide to go to a new place. They get taken to a new place. This softening of their mouth, you know, the beh in Hebrew is a hard sound. It has a dot in the middle and it has an emphasis. And the peh is a very soft sound. So they have this change in language in their approach, in their perspective. The marginal becomes the center. These guests that were uninvited, the intrusion into the city of a culture that's completely different. All of this is, I feel like, you know, if you're looking for something spiritual, it was the insertion of the divine into their lives. This was not a mistake. This was a direction, a new direction, a new opportunity. I don't know, that kind of shifted as you were talking, Ellen. Something happened inside of me. It was this awakening to the ways in which we're guided in our life to make a decision at every moment, like how we're going to play the music, who we're going to engage with, how we're going to receive the other, how we're going to approach the other, how, you know, this kind of learning because of a sudden, you know, I don't want to call it an epiphany, but a sudden shift in perception. This could have been the biggest tragedy in their lives. It turned out to be the biggest discovery for two communities who found a common language, which was neither of their languages, but they found this way to communicate. And as happens on airplanes, I'm sure to you all the time, somebody will begin revealing their whole life to you that, you know, on a plane ride. So in this chance encounter, people open themselves up in ways that are, I think, miraculous. You know, you learn about deep, dark secrets and fears and insecurities through a shared language. And I think that's the gift of dialogue. You know, you find a common language to talk about your innermost places because you've been directed there. It's not an incidental group here. This is not a chance. We are together for a purpose. And the band found their purpose and the people in the town found their purpose. And thanks to you, you've opened up the possibility that we're here for some particular purpose, finding a common language to acknowledge the insertion of the divine in our lives. Anyway, that's a whole new, I wasn't even going there until you started to talk. So thank you.
Hey, Jay, this is Jerry. I normally lag a week or two behind. I just saw Don't Look Up this week, which was pretty cool. And my comments are going to be from the trailer and not from seeing it. So I'll probably look at this over the weekend. But I was struck by hospitality. I mean, I think for anybody that's gone into a place that they don't know the language, they don't know the jokes, don't know the tradition, it's looked like from the 2-minute trailer that, and I've seen this every once in a while when you're walking outside and you cross them and you say hello, that seems to break the ice of silence, but it looked like there was a level of thoughtful hospitality extended to people who they knew weren't like them. So again, that may not drive the whole show, but I'm looking forward to seeing it. But I was struck by the willingness, you know, to say hello or extend some level of warmth.
Yeah. Thanks, Jerry.
I totally agree with Jerry. And as a matter of fact, when I was watching the film, it reminded me of a wonderful Hebrew tradition throughout the Hebrew Bible of people, you know, even if they were Bedouin type, you know, folks in the desert with tents, would always apparently, you know, open one part of their tent to travelers and would offer them a greet, didn't matter who they were, would offer them a greeting and would offer them water and food. And again, that act of hospitality goes beyond cultural barriers. And I just loved near the opening when Dina, the restaurant cook, said, well, there's no Arab cultural center here. There's no cultural center at all. There's no culture. Well, the irony of that as the film plays out is just delicious, I think, because these folks who have little in common really find a commonality in eating together and visiting, and even just the casual playing of the music by the band outside the restaurant and even inside different instruments. And again, like Ellen said, the unfinished concerto, and there's hope there, you know, and the creativity aspect of it, I think, is totally right on too. You know, we all have something that we can give to others, and we may think it's of little consequence, but it's not. You know, cooking, singing, drawing, writing. You know, we all have a gift. And I remember when I taught, was still teaching, children would often say to me, "Well, why?" Back then it was called the gifted and talented class. Why am I not in that class? Because it went according to test scores. And I would say, well, you know, this is the way I feel about that class. These children are experiencing, you know, something maybe you're not outside this classroom. But on the other hand, you have a lot of gifts, and let me tell you about them. And I'd tell the child what I thought his or her gifts were. And we all have them, and they're all meant to be shared, you know, and that goes across all cultural boundaries. And the language we speak, the universal language we speak, is love. And there was just a huge element of love in this movie, which I really, really appreciated.
Thanks, Tina. Anybody else like to speak? Nita, you're having technical difficulties. I see, you're gonna leave and come back. Yeah, anybody else have a comment they'd like to make?
Hey, Jay, this is Greg.
And hey, Greg.
I'm new to this. Thank you, Jerry, for inviting me in. I feel like, you know, first time caller, long time listener. And I'm like Jerry, I didn't see the movie yet, but what really struck me very personally was the placement in the Negev Desert. And partly that's because biographically, I had a dream. I'm a priest up here in Conway. And my call started with a dream about being in the Negev Desert. And so just the placement just knocked me away when I saw that. I'm like, and then this, I'm truly appreciative of this conversation. I hope I can rise up to the challenge because you guys are having amazing insights. So thank you.
Thanks, Greg.
Yeah.
Good to see you. Hey, Lynn, go ahead. Yeah.
I'll second what Greg just finished with. I'm grateful to connect again with y'all. And this is wonderful. I was thinking about sort of the power of compassion and sort of the ways that on the inside, if there's space for the characters and connecting with that in some way, that there's a kind of a freedom that allows the creativity to emerge more, it seems. And I don't know, I think groups like this that happen from long distances away aren't a replacement for being in person, but I'm just amazed at how there can be compassionate listening, and it takes on a life of its own in a way. Now, the last thing I was thinking, when Ellen, you were talking about intuition and God, I think very much the intuition is, to me, very much where God is. I mean, because sometimes we get caught in our head too much that we don't listen to the rest, and we call it intuition. I think maybe that's very much where God speaks to me. And I'll stop there. Thanks.
Ellen, I'd like to say a word about stuckness and also about spirituality. And sometimes when I'm with people that say I'm not very spiritual, I say, you know, fine, but from my part, I think of spirituality as emotional wisdom. And so if somebody says I'm not very spiritual, but I am interested in growing as a person in emotional wisdom, I say, well, me too. And let's not let the word spirituality get in the way. But a word about God. I myself think of God as a lure, a beckoning presence toward unstuckness. And there's something in me and maybe in you and all of us that wants not to be stuck, that wants to be unstuck. And I think that which inside us, which wants to be unstuck, is one way that God is present in us, is a lure to unstuckness. And sometimes the circumstances in which we find ourselves, which we don't actually ask for, they just happen, can be ambassadors of God, so to speak. They are circumstances that require that we become unstuck, even as we might otherwise be stuck. So I just want to put in a plug for divine unstuckness. Holy unstuckness. Sacred unstuckhood. Unstuckhood. Unstuckness.
Jay, that may be a t-shirt. We may want to have t-shirts printed up with that.
You know, the funny thing is, though, I think when we're unstuck, we may imagine there'll be a place that we'll arrive at where we're perfectly secure and calm and it's all complete. The symphony's finished. I don't think the journey past unstuckness is toward that kind of finality. So the absence of finality can be a good thing. Anybody else? Those are just my comments. Anybody else have a thought? And then we'll move to octopuses. Anybody else?
My only other comment is that I think it was very human to be uncomfortable. I mean, I think I played the oboe as a kid. It was a two-reeded instrument and it was painful for anybody to be in the room with me. But I think being awkward and having somebody say, gee, that's not bad. But I felt very empathetic to the band. Even the picture that they took at the airport with the custodian guy walking through seemed to set the tone for there was a kind of imbalance throughout the there was a lack of perfection maybe in what it is, but I really empathize with the band and, you know, being awkward, being in uniform, being in the desert, being miles away from where they're supposed to be. I thought it was a great metaphor for maybe the human condition in some way.
Yeah.
Ellen, do you have some last things you'd say for us?
I at the very, very beginning of the movie, and I don't remember if this was in the trailer, where there were words that flashed across the screen at the very beginning that said, this is a true story. And then I don't remember what comes next, but at the end it said, not many people remember this. It wasn't very important. And that's how the movie begins. And I'm thinking, I think that's how that kind of typifies how me and I and many other people feel like we're in this world and we have our very tiny place where we are possibly important, you know, to some people, but in the vast world out there, how important are we? But then when you see the film and you see that each of these people has that importance, I thought it was a message of, again, hope and just for all of us, that we are important to one another and to more the vastness that's out there.
Carol, did you want to say something right there?
Maybe just a little rider to add to Ellen, the tale, I guess, that, you know, Revelation's been known to happen in the desert before. So I find that the place was not incidental, it was significant and perhaps deliberate. And these weren't politicians, they were humble people, you know, grasping at life's meaning like most of us. And so they're so identifiable, even if the elephant in the room is that they're Israelis and Egyptians, you know, that in some sense they've taken extremes in the world and put them together in this place of revelation, and again found a common way of communicating. So I loved it as a great metaphor for our own creativity and our own ability to talk across differences in a very void, empty space that we can create a beautiful symphony out of.
Thanks, Carol. And Ellen, thanks so much also for a great movie and great presentation.
Thank you, Ellen. Lovely movie. Jay, I saw the movie last night. I saw the movie, but I didn't understand the movie because I was doing multiple things at the same time. And I could not read the subtitles. So I was watching the movie and I was hearing the movie, but I was not understanding the movie. But I absolutely loved it. I don't know the meanings. I did not even could tell that it was an Egyptian band. But I saw this group of people who were really awkward in the beginning. People who were probably put at the wrong place at the wrong time. And then slowly as the movie progressed, I saw their anxieties subsiding, they become more and more comfortable, relationships started developing and emerging, and the expressions started changing, and the tone, the sounds that I was hearing, which I could not understand a bit, they started changing. So for me, it was a very, very sweet movie about human relationships between people who didn't know each other, but very soon started to learn more and trust and love each other. And I do hope to see it again with the subtitles to understand it more. So that takes us to our next movie. So for me, it was about relationships. But then again, I haven't read the subtitles yet. And me and Ellen were talking yesterday. Both of our movies are about relationships today. So I'm going to take you to our next movie called My Octopus Teacher, which is, and I picked this movie firstly because it's just a beautiful, beautiful movie. It's, and if I hadn't picked it, Ellen would have picked it. So we both picked the movie. So Ellen, you're going to help me with this. So firstly, it's a gorgeous movie. It's a beautiful movie. The visuals are awesome. The life at the reef, at the bay, under the waters, the it feels that there's a touch of divine with every creature that you see. The sheer beauty and the wonder that we see in the visuals of the movie is just amazing. And then the movie is about a very unusual relationship between a narrator, who is Craig Foster, and an octopus that he has built the relationship with, and he spends a year with her. So the whole movie revolves around that relationship, and I want to start, before I pose my questions, I want you to see the trailer, and then we'll go to our questions. Lois, can you play it?
I remember the day when it all started. Seeing this really strange thing. A lot of people say an octopus is like an alien. But the strange thing is, as you get closer to them, you realize that we're very similar in a lot of ways. It's a hard thing to explain, but sometimes you just get a feeling and you know there's something to this creature that's very unusual. There's something to learn here. I had to have a radical change in my life. And the only way I knew to do it was to be in this ocean with her. And then I had this crazy idea. What happens if I just went every day? But you realize that there's a line that can't be crossed. Start thinking about your own vulnerability, worried about your family or child. I hadn't been a person that was overly sentimental towards animals before. I realized I was changing. My relationship with people, with humans, was changing. What she taught me was to feel that you're part of this place, not a visitor. That's a huge difference.
I saw this movie quite a few months ago. Now I feel like going back and seeing it again. So I'm going to pose a few questions from you, and the first one is for those who have seen this movie, My Octopus Teacher. I want you to, so you'll remember that Craig Foster wanted to establish a relationship with the octopus in order to learn something. Octopus became his teacher, and his whole life changed after that. So my first question is, I would like you to think that what can we learn from his experience or his relationship with the octopus? And that's for those people who have seen the movie. Now, there are two spiritual practices I want to briefly touch upon, which come to my mind as I see the movie. And first is the practice of reverence. And I talk about it because it's a very important spiritual practice in Islam as well, and we call it adab. And that's very strongly embedded in the movie, reverence in the relationships that we hold. My whole life, when I look at my whole life, I mean, it has a lot been about building and developing relationships with people, with places, with things. And sometimes those people and places are very different from where I might be familiar with. And they're very different from me. So in order to develop that relationship with those people, places, or things, there has to be adab that I have for them. There has to be this quality of reverence that I have to show towards them, in the sense that I look at these things, and we all do in some ways, that there is a touch of divine, or there is a touch of sacred in everything around us, whether it's a stone or it's a tree or it's part of a nature or another human being or cat or dog. Everything is touched by divine in one way or another. There is sacred in everything. And once we start looking at the world around us with that kind of a radical amazement, with that kind of a reverence, then we interact with people and things around us with mystery and wonder. So the spiritual practice of reverence, I want you to think about it, and I want you to use this question as well, that have you had an experience with a person or a nature or a thing that that has been really vivid and that has taught you kind of the sense of reverence for life? So have you ever had an experience, a vivid experience in nature that has taught you or cultivated a sense or a reverence of life in you? So I want you to think about Craig Foster's relationship with the octopus and what do we learn from it. I want you to think about an experience that you have had which cultivated a sense of reverence for life in you. And one last thing that I want you to think about is, which is very obvious, this whole movie is about teaching, and we all have teachers in our lives. We call them teachers, masters, sages, gurus. I call my teacher master. And we learn from them directly and indirectly. But one thing that we definitely, all of us, learn as we grow in our spiritual life is that there comes a point in our life that we learn from everything, no matter what we encounter, whether it's a person that we like or we don't like, or whether it's a thing, or whether it's an experience, positive or negative. Everything that we encounter in our life is a teacher for us. So I want you to think about teachers in your life and maybe talk about a person or an experience or an activity which has become a spiritual teacher for you in your spiritual journey. It could be a thing, a person, or any activity. So for example, I mean, you know, when COVID hit, I started taking long walks in my neighborhood, and I have a big pasture and lots of natural, just no humans, just natural space behind my home in New Jersey. And I encountered this tree, which is approximately 7 minutes walk from my home, where I found a lot of comfort. So every day I would take my book and go sit under the tree and just read it. And I saw the changes in the tree throughout the four seasons, the bare four seasons that we get in New Jersey. And I saw it changing its color from green and white to pink. And I would spend every day at least 30 minutes to an hour with that tree when I could walk, not every day, when I could walk to the tree. And that tree became kind of a teacher in my life for quite a few months for me, and a kind of a source of stability and comfort as well. So anyways, coming back to the movie, I want you to think about the movie and the relationship with the octopus. What do you learn from it? Where do you find, or how do you find reverence in life and a teacher in your life, whether it's a person, experience, or an activity who has taught you something spiritually? And anybody?
If I could say, just because you were talking about the tree, it immediately made me think of, there's a field back behind our house, and how I used to almost daily walk around it and recite scripture, something from Ephesians 3 even, and various ways that became very connected with that across the seasons. And actually, one of the things I discovered is it was spring, after they had dropped the leaves, spring, I didn't realize it. At first, I thought half of the tree was dead. And then after all that time, it took me that contrast to tell me there were two trees intertwined, two different kinds of trees. And so the hackberry was much earlier than the other. But anyway, that was just this beautiful wrapping together, and for me to awake and realize. And I guess that kind of moves to what I was thinking about. Vulnerability seems to me to be part of what helps make it a thin space, is the Celtic term, is sort of this closeness to the awareness of mystery and sacredness, reverence for, and compassion. It seems to make those connections. And I talked about it, this powerful experience for me back months ago here. T is for transformation, I think. But for me, after having treatment for cancer at St. Jude and finishing up the radiation long enough to go back to Little Rock in 2 weeks to go to school, but I could go lie down in the spring in the backyard. And for me, it was a very powerful experience of, I wasn't isolated as much as I was part of something much bigger. And that's, you know, 50 years ago. And still now one of my spiritual practices is to hear the cardinals that I kind of awakened to 50 years ago. I like to call watching the sunset back in the back, and just having reverence for, really, having for the liminal luminosity of that transition. And I guess it's all about transitions. And as Jay, you were saying earlier, there's not this final finish. There may be a kind of a telos, a completion of peace and, you know, a kind of the wholeness this experience, but then there's the next moment and whatever else it brings.
Yeah.
Thanks. Thank you, Lynn. And we remember your presentation. Good comments. Nita, I saw that you had your hand up. Did you want to say something?
Yes. I was captured by several things from the film, but one of them was that this took place in Cape Town, and I have been to that part of the ocean, and it's where the Indian and Atlantic meet, and so it's pretty volatile there on the point of the Cape. And the fact that this man would go every day to commune with this octopus was pretty amazing. And then when he mentioned that the octopus would only have 1 year of life to reproduce, have babies, and die, I thought of the urgency of relationship and the preciousness of it, the reverence that we really should and need to hold to live fully, I think is a very important part of that movie. And then as far as a personal teacher, gosh, I have so many, but nature is a big deal to me. And I have a pair of great horned owls that visit me almost daily, nightly or early morning. So much to the point that I've named them Eleanor and Franklin, because I just think they're amazing creatures. And I have learned to talk with them, and they come right up to me, and then they sit outside my bedroom window often and just sing to me, talk to me. And the messages are more than I can say in this small space, but nature is our teacher, people are our teachers, the ocean's our teacher. And I loved the amazing facts about the octopus. I learned so much. It was great. So thank you for choosing that film.
Jay, you are on mute. You're still muted, Jay. Okay.
So, all right. I think you can hear me now. Thank you.
Yeah.
Anybody else? Response to Sophia's three questions, really. Have you seen the movie? Okay, Carol.
I probably wouldn't have chosen it, but thanks to you, I did see it. And Neil saw it with me and feels terrible. He was called away to a meeting. He so wanted to contribute. So I'll try and answer your question, Sophia. I think when I think back on my very first, what I would call spiritual experience, was when I was a little girl, I must have been 7 or something, playing with a stick, and other children were also playing in this mound of earth, and there was an ant colony, and they were about to kill the ants. And I really had a moment of connection with the ants, and I saw their life. I saw the life in them. And I, you know, had to walk away from there crying, because they were living entities. And I guess what I saw was their divinity, their, what we say in Hebrew, Kedusha, their holiness, their wholeness, their, and I, and that moment stayed with me, put it away, you know, I put it away for more, let's say, advanced studies and a language and theology that, you know, but that moment really was the first connection that I had to the life in all of life, and the presence of the divine in all of life. And I probably would have just forgotten about it till you sort of resurrected it for me. So thank you for that return of a memory. The language you used at the outset, radical amazement and wonder, are from my teacher, Dr. Abraham Joshua Heschel, who Neil was a student of, and I was always in awe of him as a personality and as a human being. So that's his language. He gave us that language to ask for wonder, to never become dulled to the presence in our lives. And So it's that language that keeps me coming back to non-dulling, removing a film, or the, you know, allowing the lore, allowing myself to be invited into life over and over again through the presence of others and living, other living beings. And the last thing I want to say is that during COVID, when things were pretty dramatic for Neil and I, we are on a property that's very isolated at the back of a synagogue that we don't attend. So, you know, it's not our community and everyone wasn't coming anyway, but we're surrounded by nature. There are trees and flowers and birds that constantly, squirrels that constantly come, deer, you know, bunny rabbits constantly came to visit us when we were so isolated. These were our guests daily. And I remember being in an interfaith session in online where people were talking about the Psalms and singing the songs as a form of meditation during these trying days. And someone was talking about the anguish and the suffering and, you know, all the things that went along with the beginnings of COVID, the losses. And there was a bird outside my window building a nest. And I watched her every single day. It was a reaffirmation of life for me. She probably has no idea what she gave to me, but it's the promise of life again, the world renewing itself. Just through her actions, I was inspirited, enlivened. And so I want to thank you for that. Watching the octopus was just such a revelation, because it's a life form I know nothing about. It's a universe I know nothing about. And so my world grew as a result of his visits with his beloved partner. And Neil's comment said, please tell Sophia, that one of the moments for Neil that was so outstanding was that he did not intervene with her life cycle. He didn't save her life. He didn't intervene. He was purely there to witness her life and not take over in any way, shape, or form. So thank you for this movie.
Sophia, in Thailand, there was a tradition of monks, Buddhist monks in Thailand, that would ordain trees. And they would wrap a ribbon around a tree to say, this tree is one of our teachers. This is a priest. And that would then prevent the woodcutters from cutting down the tree. So it was combined with political protest. But they would ordain trees. And that gives me the idea of ordaining other things too. And so I myself have two dogs. And one of the dogs has been in the room the whole time that we've had this conversation until just recently. But I really love that dog. I love them both. Are they teachers? I don't know. But are they sources of comfort and inspiration and amazement and laughter and friendship? Yes, they are. And so I find, you know, if somebody said, Jay, do you think, are your dogs ministers? Could we ordain your dogs? I'd say, of course. Please do. There's a whole lot of things that are ministers in my life. And I'm guessing in your a rabbi, an imam, lots of imams. One thing I wondered about, Sophia, for you and for all of us, Carol put in a note saying, in effect, was COVID sent by God? And at least I'll put it that way. Let me say, I think the answer to that is no. For me, I don't think of God as directing things like that. I don't. But I do think that God is inside me to learn from almost everything. So while things weren't willed by God, those things can become teachers, even the hard things, if I choose to learn from them. So in a way, it's a sense that
I choose my teachers. I was just wondering, how about for you? Is there a role of choice in what you decide you will learn from, what you decide will be your teacher?
It's interesting you put it up, because I would like for others to respond to that, because I do feel that we make so many mistakes in life, which is fine, and we make them over and over again, because sometimes we choose not to learn from beings who we don't choose and pick as teachers. I mean, I have made a choice to pick somebody who is my spiritual teacher, and many more. I never picked my children as my teachers. I would never do that. But they have been my biggest teachers. I have learned the most from them. And my cats. They have been, I mean, the quality of perseverance that I learned from my cats, I couldn't learn it from anybody. So yes, we can make a choice to choose or not choose somebody as a teacher. But we do learn from anything and many thing around us. But I'll let others respond to your question too. And Ellen, I do wanna call on to you, if you're still here, because this was also your movie of choice. And I borrowed the first question from you. So I want you to reflect on your own experience of watching this movie and learning from it.
Ellen, would you respond, please?
Do you want me to respond? Yeah, I also thought it was a most beautiful movie. I'm not acquainted with the ocean except to put my toes in when the waves come close. And I was taught to be fearful of the ocean because you could drown so easily. So that there's that. And so I just thought it was such a beautiful movie, and the connection that was made between this animal and the diver, as I expressed to Sophia, I thought had so much to teach us, not just because it was something that I was not aware of. I mean, I used to teach about invertebrates when I taught science to sixth graders, but it's much more than that. And an awareness grew within me to see how this animal had so much what we call emotional intelligence, and also intelligence in something that I was taught was not like that. And so it was really a fantastic realization to me that you can't trust the science books necessarily. You can't trust, you know, what's in the lesson plans that they provide in a curriculum guide, but you have to really seek out and go outside of your what would be normal in order to find this radical amazement in things that are so unfamiliar. The one short story that I have is that at Temple B'nai Israel, the sanctuary is constructed so that when you are sitting in the seats facing the Holy Ark, there are two long windows, and those windows face out to trees and kind of a little woods area that surrounds the temple. So the temple is a little bit secluded purposefully because of nature, but also for other reasons. And so when you're in the sanctuary, you feel like you're surrounded by nature. There are two crows, I guess they're crows, big black birds, that are sometimes an annoyance because they're the ones that are picking at the roadkill, or they're the ones that, you know, you see as scavengers, or they're the ones that are cawing in the morning and waking you up or whatever. But these two birds, which I learned, have a marriage, and they know to come and sit on this particular branch in this tree with all of us looking at them on Saturday morning when we went in person. When the service was taking place, we would watch. If you got there on time, you would see these two birds come and sit on this branch, stay for the entire hour and a half service, and when we would get up to leave, they would go and fly away. And I don't know what they did in the meantime, but every Saturday when I was there, these birds were there too. So whether they were hearing the music that came through these triple pane windows, whether they just enjoyed watching us or whether they knew that this was Shabbat and that it was time for them to take a break, I don't know, but somehow I connected to them and I couldn't miss a Shabbos because I thought, if the birds are going to be there, if they can be there, then I actually have to be there too. So in that way, I felt like I was part of this natural experience and they were teaching me something too.
Thank you for sharing that, Ellen. And I, you do touch on that point that I do believe we can always, there is always room to learn more. And we can learn from many around us who we might never think our teachers are. Jay, do you have any closing comment before I close the class, or do you want to say anything?
I don't, but what a great discussion, and thanks to everybody.
It was a wonderful discussion. If you believe in the transforming power of the movies like I do, or if there's a place in your heart and soul that has been enriched by a movie, please email us and share that movie with us so we can bring it to the class. I want to, since our class today was very much about building relationships, I want to finish with this poem, which is one of my favorite poems in this book, which have, we have used a lot, Spiritual Literacy as a Text. And that's how we go, and this is where we close today's class. It's a poem by Quan Tao Sheng, and it goes, take a lump of clay. Take a lump of clay, wet it, pat it, break it, knead it, and make a statue of you. Then make a statue of me. Now shatter them, clatter them, break them, pull them apart. Add some water and mold them again, knead them again into a statue of you and a statue of me again. Then in mine there are bits of you, and in you there are bits of me. Nothing ever can keep us apart as we all reside in each other. Sending light and love to you all. Salam, peace, and shalom.